Starfleet officer struggles to survive.
No one can understand until they sit in the chair.
Now, a revolutionary procedure could be the key to a whole new future on the next episode of Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Welcome one and all back to the depths of DS9. We are here to evaluate yet another season 2 episode, albeit perhaps not a standout. I am joined this week by Mr. Moore McGill. How the fuck are you, sir?
I'm doing well, thank you. How are you?
No one cares. In rating Melora as an episode, I feel you must first do what pathetically few reviewers, pundits, or clickbaiters are inclined to do and try some research on for size. What I find most people remain oblivious to, rather, is that Melora is actually less an individual episode in its own right than a sort of sneak peek into a DS9 cast member that never really was. I mean, the idea to have a member of the main crew that existed in a low-G environment apparently actually dates back to damn near the first fucking pitch meeting. But I guess budgetary bullshit and simple impracticality relegated it to a single episode that, curiously, didn't really materialize until season 2. Melora is not supposed to be a guest star. She's supposed to be a member of the crew, apparently.
Tragic.
Yeah, well, and I guess it was representational a little bit. It was supposed to be handicapped. Hey, Ira, put that on your little checklist there for the DS9
documentary.
That's
what I was thinking, actually.
You were gonna, right? You were going to represent the handicapped. Not merely a writing staff.
Handy capable.
Right. Indeed. I'm not sure how I feel about this one. I like it. I've never felt that it deserves as much hate as it gathers in certain quarters, but still not the best of the season.
What sort of hate does it gather?
Just that it's generally characterized as a throwaway episode.
Yeah.
As, you know, it's kind of a, I don't want to call it a bottle episode. Well, it sort of is. There's not really a whole lot else that takes place except for the subplot with Quark and he's going to get killed, which works.
I've come to kill you, Quark.
I mean, that whole thing works, but it's infinitely more interesting than the main plot at times, unfortunately, which is always a problem. Quark tends to upstage a lot of lesser storylines, I find, as the series goes on.
Well, he has continuity.
A fun fact about this, speaking of how they really plan for this to be an actual main cast member, they actually built an entire wirework soundstage on the DS9 set for just this episode, suggesting Melora was actually meant to at least be a recurring character. They left that thing up for 4 fucking seasons without once bringing her back.
Yeah.
I have to believe she was supposed to come back at some point, but, you know.
They probably justified the construction of this set as, you know, like, we could use this again for something else, you know, like,
right.
It's a space station. At some point, they're going to be in zero G. The station could lose power or something of that kind.
And it's hilarious because they simply did not. They didn't use it. And it's funny because wasn't there some zero G shit on Voyager at times? There was like an episode where Tom Paris and B'Elanna Torres were like out in space in their space suits and being boring together, and they profess their undying affection for one another. I imagine that episode would have come in handy to have the zero G set there, but you know what? Knowing CBS, knowing Paramount, it's a mortal certainty they probably didn't avail themselves of it.
Right. Well, I think that it was probably very specific to, like, quarters interior of DS9, right? Because that's where a lot of the zero-G takes place with Melora and Bashir. So
indeed.
Probably it was a difficult set to deconstruct.
Indeed. And they wound up, I believe, as the Defiant set expanded, they wound up finally having to knock it down. And that was not until the fifth or sixth season, which is pretty nuts. That's quite a bit of waste, actually, because I imagine that cost a lot to construct.
Yeah, just having an entire set in mothballs for that long is
it's
a pretty big waste.
More to the point, like, while I'm a big advocate of the Dax-Bashir relationship, this episode is sort of a prime example of how DS9's writers sort of, I don't know, inadvertently sabotaged the whole endeavor. Blue Balls Bashir has the hard-on of the century for the broken bitch, and she's never once in danger of giving a fuck, even when she's a raging cunt stain directly to her face.
Welcome to DS9, Ensign. I'm Chief Science Officer Jedzia Dax, and this is...
Dr. Bashir, we spoke on subspace.
Good to meet you in person.
I see you have my trolley car ready to go.
As requested.
Can I help?
I'm fine, thank you.
When do you wish to leave, Lieutenant?
Your schedule is fine with me.
Then tomorrow at 07:30.
Right? Dax is standing there. They're supposed to have some sort of at least an amorous arrangement. And she's standing there. Melora just unleashes right to her face. She doesn't even care. She legitimately doesn't care that Bashir is carrying on with Cripples McGee there, which is part of the problem, I think. It's funny. In the documentary that we just reviewed, I think... Bashir's actor, what is his name, Sadiq El-Fadil, he was giving an interview and he said something to the effect of, you know, it was like I was punching above my weight when I was supposed to be in a relationship with Dax there.
She was suddenly my love interest. I was punching above my weight when I was on the same stage with Terry.
Are all your leaders women?
Yes.
All of them?
You heard her, Julian.
Jadzia had no need for Bashir.
And the truth is, they never really had one. You know what I mean? The writers just never really pulled the trigger on it, and it just kind of stayed at this weird flirtatious sort of level, which is why it's kind of weird to lay that at the actors' feet, you know?
Well, they don't have chemistry. I mean, for whatever reason, it's Terry Farrell's body language or just her delivery of any of the times when she's supposed to be flirting with Bashir, which could be an entree to something larger, you never get the feeling that she's actually into him at all or that she really is necessarily in need of service.
Right.
I mean, she doesn't put that out there.
But here's an interesting fact, and I think that actually upends that a little bit. They give Melora several character attributes that Jadzia herself would later have.
I know how it looks, but...
Bacar de la Fracnel?
Dogabol Ratar!
De Tel Crapaboul!
Poc de Bol!
De Car del Gardena!
I like a customer who knows what she wants.
There's nothing worse than half-dead racht.
These are all things Dax would later boast.
Ah, la bella goo.
She taught that to me. Can you believe it? A Klingon song I'd never heard.
So it's like, the writers know how to give Bashir a decent love interest. They just don't want it to be Dax for whatever goddamn reason. It's really fucking weird. I mean, when you break it down, they gave this girl's character traits to Dax later on.
Yeah.
Really odd. Really odd.
I don't think that Terry Farrell really carried Dax the way that would actually make sense for Bashir to be a real love interest of hers. What Alexander Siddig said in his interview in What We Left Behind, the documentary, is really telling, and maybe it's his own feeling or something he just inferred from all of the writing, but Bashir really doesn't seem like the equal to Dax. He doesn't seem able to cut the mustard because he's just a little too, you know, he's a little too cutesy, a little bit too, not exactly smarmy, but he's a little too juvenile for Dax. I mean,
he's the tenderfoot in season.
Yeah, you don't ever get the feeling that he could put the moves on her.
Right.
You really don't get the feeling that he could ever be romantically aggressive or, you know, make an overture that would be successful.
Yeah, and it's funny because Bashir gets reinvented later on, and you could absolutely see it happening at that point. Right, because, you know, you have the whole episode where he's literally James fucking Bond.
Let's lie down.
I must say, Major Kira's certainly throwing herself into the role, Doctor.
Nerys, please.
You have lots and lots of stuff that suggests Bashir is a smooth bastard, but it doesn't come for another, like, four or five seasons.
Yeah, you know I mean? Alexander Siddig might not have even been there either. I don't remember how old he is when he starts, right. But he's pretty young.
Yeah, he's probably... No, he's not the youngest cast member. I believe Dax actually was.
Dax is 28.
Yeah, she her actress at that time was mid-late 20s
or
something.
But she has the aloof personality.
Right.
And she doesn't give you... She's aloof. Melora's character... is initially rather quite frigid, brittle, aggressive.
Right.
But
in
then
short,
she melts.
What Dax would be over the course of four seasons or whatever.
Well, you know, well, she's like insecure and defensive, which
right.
is a good. Mm-hmm. It's a good entree for Bashir because he is the doctor, and giving him a bird with a wounded wing to tend to is just about what was intended here.
I really don't mean to.
Sure, you do.
I beg your pardon.
Of course you mean to. All of these broad shots you fire, they're just your way of keeping the rest of the universe on the defensive. Has to be. You're too good at it. I came here thinking about asking you to dinner.
Then afterwards we'll go dancing, I suppose.
Red alert.
And I have to say, while I think Melora would have been an interesting cast member, one can see how someone perpetually hobbling about with a wheelchair and a goddamn Gandalf stick might be the faintest bit fucking distracting.
Well, they had to make the fucking set ADA compliant functionally. I mean, that must have been a fucking pain in the ass.
Especially because apparently...
All of those raised little
right,
ridges.
every single area has a lip on it. Apparently,
I know.
They literally had to put a ramp on
it
them.
It fucking kills me that they had to build that shit. They had to build all of that.
What kind of an architect would deliberately design a raised rim at the entrance to every door?
This is either an example of one hand not understanding what the other hand is doing, or it was a genius move from the writers. I don't know which it was, but it was absolute distilled essence of brilliance to call attention to the absurdity of the alien with the umbilical cord in front of his fucking mouth having him sit down to eat.
Yes.
Jumbo!
Vulcan mollusk. Sauteed in Rombolian butter. A taste so exquisite it's to die for. Or to live for that matter.
That was unbridled goddamn hilarity.
The entire time I'm watching that, I'm thinking, like, this species could never have evolved.
Right?
Like, that would never have... That's not adaptive at all. What the fuck does that even do? That little... bit of cartilaginous thing that's like a little foreskin on his
got a little tampon string across his mouth, and that's the thing.
Any halfway logical person would have just taken a Bowie knife and severed it.
By the way, this episode has the Odo reaction image of the century when Odo is informed that the scrote-faced alien is out to kill Quark's ass.
I would imagine Thallet Kott is looking for his own kind of justice now.
He threatened to kill me. What?
Nothing. Just a passing thought.
Just the look of absolute effusive happiness when he's informed that Quark might die. Goddamn, René Auberginois went above and beyond on that one, I have to say.
Yeah, we might get sun tomorrow.
I must say, scenes like the one where Bashir basically invents a cure for wheelchairs.
It's stimulating acetylcholine absorption to increase tensile strength.
The neuromuscular adaptation theory?
It was a theory 30 years ago. But with the development of neoanaleptic transmitters, it's not even that complicated. It's just that no one's ever gone back to re-examine the ideas of Nathaniel Terros. Until now.
Are a prime example of what a genius move the coming Bashir retcon was.
Yeah.
Because if you don't know anything about what's happening with Bashir yet, and we won't spoil it for people who are watching along with us, it's hilarious. Otherwise, it would come across as just a deus ex machina, which it is. It totally is. Yeah. As far as the writers are concerned,
right,
for this
season
anyway.
Right, but they did that often enough with him that the retcon... helped complete the deal.
Yeah, the guy's got a bottomless bag of Deus Ex Machina, and now suddenly, I think it's fifth or sixth season, somewhere thereabouts.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all explained, like why that was, and
why
why
he can just look back in the medical textbooks and say, "Oh, I can finish that."
Right, I can finish this fucking.
No one else has bothered to. For hundreds of years, but I can do that.
I can cure being crippled.
Oh, and by the way, of course, it it makes no sense that a bipedal humanoid would evolve to look nearly the same as a human in a low gravity environment.
Oh yeah.
Like there's literally no way that would happen. But whatever.
Right? Wouldn't they be like impossibly tall or
and lanky? Right. You know, like their entire endoskeleton would be less focused on supporting flesh. They wouldn't need to.
Entire planet of Ann Coulters. I got you. I always felt that. I always felt that star-crossed lovers, you must choose between gravity and living in a fucking fishbowl shit, was Kate Moss fucking thin.
When does this become irreversible?
Melora, if you're not certain...
No, I'm sure it's just some strange form of buyer's remorse. I'll be fine.
It made no sense whatsoever because, what kind of sense does that make? Because there are plenty of people who live in what's nominally 1G who go to 0G and hang out all the time.
Right! You're in Starfleet. You mean to tell me that before Starfleet happened, humans never existed in a low-G environment?
Right.
I know for goddamn certain Starfleet space stations weren't born with fucking gravity coils.
I mean, we've put humans into 0G for 6 months at a time in the early 21st century or the late 20th century, whichever.
Right.
You know, and so it's not that much of a trick. I mean, you can definitely have a shared existence.
Right! And it's a plot device you can see from outer space.
That's the problem with it. The writing is a little bit too obvious and broad, and it's just a contrivance that moves you from one plot point to the next and doesn't do any other work or even fit within the logical assembly of the structure.
And then they make it worse. They call attention to the lazy plot device by pointing out that it comes from a fucking children's book.
Oh, yes, right? They do.
A Little Mermaid. Mermaid? It's an Earth fable by Hans Christian Andersen. She trades her magical life under the sea for a pair of legs to walk on land.
I wasn't sure what the intent was with that. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if this is supposed to be some sort of like latter day fable, but it doesn't really end up working. Like the pieces are there, but the transitions are clumsy. The necessity, the jeopardy don't really come in and sit as fully fleshed out pieces of the plot. They just kind of get plopped in.
Right.
And it's, I don't know, hang together well.
It was apparently written by a guy who was confined to a wheelchair, from what I understand, and he wasn't a regular staff writer.
He
was one of these guys, DS9 and all the Star Trek shows at that time took spec scripts from people, unsolicited scripts, and this was one of them that came through, apparently, and it was one that was sitting on the back burner for a while. The idea of having Melora, because they couldn't have her as a main cast member, she was just sitting on a whiteboard somewhere, you know what I mean? Episode that was unfinished, and then when this guy came in and needed his first DS9 script, I guess he was like, okay, fine, I'll take that one. I'll finish the one no one else will. And hey, it got his foot in the door, or his wheel in the door, whatever the fuck.
I can see from like a writerly point of view how this would have been an episode which is like feasible and could be done. It's like actionable, but it's not really a great episode, and it might not even be a pretty good episode. It's a fair to middling episode. It's a nice gesture toward certain issues, I suppose, and sentiments.
Right.
But it's not really an episode of Star Trek.
Yeah, it feels like this should have been a character on the show, and this should have been a long-running subplot or something. Like, Bashir and her wanting to get together, not really being able to. She decides not to go through with the treatments. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like it would have worked better as a season-long subplot while some other shit is going on. You know what I mean?
And I could see if they gave it time and if they developed it right and if they came up with some interesting plot hooks. Like, for example, if the station were attacked and completely lost power and gravity of all kind, that would have been Melora's moment to shine.
Right.
That would have been, like, a good way of exploring the same thing, but it
didn't
work.
Ever have to go outside of the space station for some reason. I mean, for Christ's sake.
Anything where there could be, you know, like, the loss of power, you know, something which turns the regular crew members into invalids would have been a good hook. They do that a little bit on the runabout, but it lasts for about 40 seconds.
And I have to say, I think if you're going to confine this to just the one episode, which I don't know if that was the plan at the time, like I said, but I think it actually would have been less hacky to have her die during the hijacking to save everyone else. I think that's evidence they intended to bring her back, but for whatever reason decided not to. Either way, at the end of the day, we thought that Bashir was going to get his end wet, but apparently it's back to the bottle for Blue Balls Bashir.
Poor bastard.
I don't know about you. For me, I'd give it... I'm generous with this because I like the concept and I like the idea that it could have been a crew member, and I actually like the actress. I thought she was very good.
She did a good job. That was a good performance.
Yeah, it's a good concept. Doesn't flow the best as an episode, and the Quark shit comes off as a bit disjointed because it doesn't really relate in any way.
Could have been a different episode. Could have been its own episode.
Absolutely could have. I give it a three out of five.
A 3 out of 5.
Not the best, not the worst. I think I'm generous with it because I like the concept and I like the character.
I'm going to give it a flat 2.5.
That's fair. I mean, yeah. I think that's fair.
It's right in the middle.
The pacing is glacial. Like, it's not... It's one of the worst paced Deep Space Nine episodes to this date for a fucking fact.
And it's not entirely memorable either.
Right. Well, I do remember Quark almost dying and all that shit. I do absolutely remember that.
It's kind of run-of-the-mill for him, though. Quark dies.
It is run-of-the-mill.
Quark almost dies a lot.
And it also must be said, for a guy who's almost going to get killed or whatever, like you feel like they could have maybe put some action in there.
Right.
And that didn't really happen. The closest we ever get to action is when Melora gets shot with a fucking phaser and, does her little zero-G shit. Which is sort of her moment to shine, but I don't know. Either way, I think it's a middling episode, even when you're being as optimistic as humanly possible, which I think I am. I mean, short of huffing helium, I don't think I could be any more forgiving. It's okay.
Yeah.
And it's nice. It is nice to see Bashir in that role as sort of a leading man a little bit. You could see that
almost
there was
kind of.
You could see there was potential there for his character that wasn't really being fulfilled, I have to say.
I wonder when he actually, in his life, I wonder when he started to think of himself as a guy who could put the moves on someone. It's certainly not in this episode.
It definitely isn't. I also have to say, don't we get another rule of acquisition?
Is it the 190th or the 189th?
Rule of acquisition number 16.
A deal is a deal. Rule of acquisition number 16.
Fair enough. All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, that does it for Melora. We will return next week with another review of the depths of DS9. For Mormagil.
As the space station slowly turns.
For Mormagil, I'm Captain Fist. Engage.
Call me at the first sign of trouble.
What if the first sign is the last sign?
You people sell pieces of yourself after you die, don't you?
Yes.
I'll buy one.